Well, how are you doing? I'm Richard Bewes, the rector of All Souls Church in Langham Place in the middle of London, England. And it's my honour and privilege to lead us in this study. And we're going to take today a solemn theme. It's the theme of man, his rebellion and fall. And I think we should start with a reading. It's a bit solemn. It's Ephesians chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live, when you followed the ways of this world, and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature, and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. Now, we'll take this seriously, and to help us in our study just at this point, Marion Byrne, working in London, and also Paul Blackham from Lancashire, but also working in London at the moment with me. Paul, when we think about the rebellion and fall of the human race, why do we call Adam innocent rather than righteous? There's a difference, isn't there?
There is, and it is perhaps a helpful thing to do, because in the Bible, no one begins perfect. Perfection and maturity, it takes time. There's testing. Are you really, what are you like? Now, Adam, of course, is innocent. He's created very good. There's no evil in him in that sense. But if we remember Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 10, where even Jesus, he's born, he becomes perfect through suffering, through obedience and that sort of thing. So it's kind of a helpful thing for us to think that there's Adam, he's created, he's innocent. Now, the question is, what's he going to do with this innocence and freedom?
Yes. So, Marion, if we can go on then. If Adam went wrong so quickly, doesn't this show that he was badly made? Now, this is an argument, isn't it? It could be.
It could be. But I don't think that would be very biblical. If we looked at Genesis even in particular, when God created man, you look in Genesis 1, so God created man and woman. He created them in his own image. He created them male and female. He created them. And you look down at the end of chapter 1 and it says, and God saw that all that he had made, and it was very good. So man and woman are made in the image of God, and it's a very good creation. So it's not the problem with creation. There's something that's gone wrong on the way. And I think it's important to see that actually what happened was it's when Adam actually turned from God. He didn't trust God. The problem was he just said, I don't want to trust you, God. And he actually rebelled against him. And it's from that actually the image of God in man and woman became marred and distorted. And actually, it's almost like if you have light and you turn off the light switch, it becomes darkness. That's what happens. It's actually the absence of the light is the problem here. It's the absence. It's not so much that creation wasn't good. It was the fact that Adam just said, no, actually, God, I don't want to trust in your goodness. And Augustine actually had a quote. Augustine has written something, Saint Augustine, which I have here, which is, the evil angels, though created good, became evil by their voluntary defection from the good, so that the cause of evil is not the good, but defection from the good. And I think that's important to understand. So it's not the creation that's bad. It's actually this not trusting God and turning away from God that's the problem.
That's very important for us to remember, it seems, because obviously light and goodness were the original principles from ever. Mm. And evil comes in as an intrusion, or as you put it, or as Augustine puts it, a defection. So there is the human race, Adam, choosing between himself or God. It's one or the other, and he makes the choice. But why did the Lord put this decision before the human race, Paul? If he hadn't put the tree in the Garden of Eden, there wouldn't have been a fall.
That's true. And the question is that people sort of say, what's he doing, the Lord? That's the question is, why does he do this? I think the first thing to realise is it's an incredibly simple and easy thing that he puts before them. And what he's really putting before the human race is the gospel. He's really saying, you can do anything you want. Here's the whole world. I just put this little tiny thing, say, all you have to do is not eat from this one tree. Now, are you going to trust me? The Lord's saying, do you? Are you going to trust and love me? Of course you do. Of course you trust and love me. That's okay, isn't it? And it's really the gospel being presented Is Adam going to be a gospel person or not? Is he going to trust the Lord or is he going to trust himself? And that comes out in Hosea chapter 6, verse 7. It's a famous little verse, and it's when the Lord, through Hosea, is saying to Judah that your love for me, Lord complains, and he says, your love for me is very quickly gone. It's like morning mist. You say you love me, but you actually don't really. And then he says, like Adam, you know, you've broken the covenant. The covenant's God's phrase for the gospel all the way through the Old Testament. So it's saying, like Adam, you've turned away from the gospel too. And I think the thing to remember is that really it was an opportunity rather than a temptation, the tree. It's like saying, here's a great opportunity to show that you trust me. All you have to do is not eat that. Then you've shown you've trusted me. You've shown you're a gospel person, Adam. And because it was such an incredibly simple and easy thing, that's why the consequences were so terrible. Because such to spurn the gospel when it's so easy to accept it, trusting the Lord, that's why it's so bad. It shows that Adam had really made his decision, and the human race too. No, we trust ourselves. We'll decide about good and evil, not you. So that's the issue.
And it's alarming, because really all along the line we've carried on in the same tradition. I was reading a book not long ago on morality and ethics, but taking the concept of God right out of it. The last chapter was entitled Deciding for Ourselves. Mm. And I thought that goes right back to the Garden of Eden and the first fall. But is it necessary, when we go back to the Garden of Eden and the fall, Marion, is it really necessary to say that this really happened once upon a time?
Well, I think it's important to understand that it did happen. If it didn't happen, the rest of the Bible doesn't make any sense. Christ makes no sense. The gospel, what's the need of having Jesus in the first place? But I think it's also important because the Bible tells us that actually it did happen, that Adam was the one who sinned. Certainly, if you look at Romans 5 and say verse 12, therefore just as sin entered the world through one man and death through sin, and in this way death came to all men because all sinned, you know, it's saying that at the time, just as, you know, that sin entered the world through Adam. And that's pointing back to the fact that this actually did happen. And in a way, it's necessary to say that it happened, and not just once upon a time, because otherwise it makes no point of looking forward to Jesus coming and rescuing the whole of the world from sin, and ultimately then looking forward to heaven when we're actually joined as a people, one people, in heaven with God.
It means that the chapter 3 of Genesis is just about the most important chapter in the whole of the Bible, because we start with the purity and the innocence of the garden. Then suddenly you're into chapter 4 and there's murder going on. Mm-hmm. And if we hadn't had chapter 3, you'd say, what on earth has happened? Mm-hmm. But chapter 3 explains it all. But is the story of the fall a realistic one, Paul? Do people really behave like that?
Well, I think we've just touched on that, really. And it does. When we look at Adam and Eve in Genesis chapter 3, I never look at them and think, oh, how peculiar. I always look at them and think, exactly, just the same. It's when they've sinned, they're ashamed, they try to hide from God. And that's exactly, I mean, throughout the rest of the Bible, you even remember when the people in Exodus and when they come to the Mount Sinai and there's the Lord, they say, no, no, Moses, you go, we can't bear to be near him. And you think, oh yeah, that's what sin does. It makes us, we don't want to be near the Lord. Just like Adam and Eve instinctively tried to hide from him. They tried to cover themselves up with fig leaves, you know, a pathetic covering to try and cover up for what they've done. And then when finally they're called out into the open and the Lord says, right, confess, I know what you've done, let's just be open about it. They won't even be open then. The game's up, it's all exposed, but they still try to come up with excuses. Oh, it wasn't really my fault, it was Eve's fault. Oh, no, it wasn't really, but it was the serpent's fault. You know, passing the book, refusing to confess and acknowledge it. And that explains why the heart of receiving the gospel is about, if you confess your sins, he's faithful and just. Just to confess your sins is totally contrary to human nature in that way. So, no, when you read them, we think, that rings true. That's just what we're like.
So how does the fall, then, make sense of human life, Marion? I mean, how does it help me to understand myself?
I think it makes a lot of sense of human life, as we talked about. you know, we got to Genesis 4 and all of a sudden you start to see murder happening. There's a spiral of sin that starts as life starts to go out of control. And you start to see, actually, well, there's so much chaos in this world, so much suffering. Why are we like that? Why is it so evil? And actually, Romans 1:18 tells us, well, you know, God has made it clear since creation. Romans 1, since what may be known about God is plain to the world, because God has made it plain to us since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities have been seen, so that men, in verse 20, are without excuse. So we start to understand, well, that's what's going wrong with the world. And for me as a Christian, it helps me to understand too that actually my life is going to be struggling with sin as well. There's a lot of things that go with understanding. I understand that I've been made in the image of God for God, but I'm also a sinful human being. And as a Christian, you know, say you took Romans 7, you can see that I'm going to have that constant battle of my sinful nature in me, wanting to do the things that I don't want to do when I want to actually please God. So in many ways, understanding sin helps me to have that great confidence in Christ for what he's done for me, but understanding realistically that we're still battling with it in this world where we live here, waiting for Christ's return.
It's alarming, but it's also, I suppose, it's encouraging too. I mean, we're told to be aiming for perfection as Christian people. Make perfection your aim and be perfect as I am perfect. And that sounds impossible. Actually, it is impossible, but we're still told, make it your aim. It would be ridiculous if Jesus had said to us, could you just try and sin a little less, please? that would be good. But no, you're to be like him. Mm. And so even to settle for it and say, what about 95%? Sorry about that last 5%. If we do that, we are already backsliders. Mm. So we have to understand that although we're not going to achieve it in this life, nevertheless, we make perfection our aim, and we can live with that tension once we understand that tension, just as Paul the Apostle had to understand it. As an advanced believer, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? Then he says, I thank God through Jesus. And it's the same with us, because all around we have reminders of the fall. The key and the lock. Why do you have to have a key? Why bother about locks? You're passing your ticket, handing your ticket. Why do you need a ticket? Because you can't be trusted. We cannot be trusted. Well, I remember getting off an aeroplane at one of the airports of the developing countries. And as I got out, there were AK-47 rifles all around me. And I thought, after this huge technological leap from one part of the world to the other part of the world, how far the human race has advanced to be able to make that tremendous leap. But we get off at the other end, AK-47s all around. You know, we haven't actually advanced one little bit morally without the help of Jesus Christ. And maybe that's where we end off our study at this point, that without the help of God, we remain fallen people and condemned to an eternity outside of God. But the redemption side, that's another story.